Well, welcome. It is September the 27th, 2017, about 2 minutes after one. And we are at the Travis County Commissioner's Courtroom here at 700 Lavaca Street. That's 78701. And this is the Balcones Canyonland Conservation Plan Coordinating Committee meeting. And I will call this meeting to order. So you have me, Commissioner Gerald Darty, as co-chair, and Councilmember Leslie Poole. So why don't we get started with first thing that we generally do is citizens' communication. And the first speaker is Thomas Pontine. Welcome, Thomas. And I don't think we have the timer, but we give everybody about 3 minutes.
I won't have to read this. My dyslexia gets worse in the evenings.
Okay.
Good afternoon. My name is Thomas Pontine. Soon, the revised chapter of the land management plan on public access is going to become for your approval. This board directed the revision of that document on November 28, 2007. Mayor Nguyen and you were on the board. This document is of great interest to all the park users because it governs access to three of the major Austin parks. The Barton Creek Greenbelt, the Bull Creek Park, and Emalon Metropolitan Park are included on those parks. This revised document, it also addresses grandfather uses, plus the new guidelines and opening new lands for recreational, the possible recreation. As citizen participation, I wish to participate in the approval process by being able to study the document and bring my comments directly back to this board as an agenda item. This agenda item would happen on the following meeting after staff presents the document. So we have enough time to study the document and be ready to make our comments. If some kind of task force is created for this purpose, I would like to be part of the directive. I suggest, as is normally traditional to do that, that this group would be independent from staff. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Ron Hensley. Welcome, Ron.
Hi, thank you. I would just like to sort of second Tomas's suggestion.
Ron, why don't you start with your name that way?
Sorry, can you hear me? This is Ron Hensley.
Okay.
I'd like to second Tomas's input on some mechanism for the public to have input into the document that governs public access. I think Tomas is suggesting a methodology, but which I'm fine with. The main thing I want to make sure is that we somehow or another get citizen input on citizen access to the parks. And I would, if we need someone to do that from a citizen point of view, I'd be happy to volunteer.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Kent Browning.
Good afternoon. My name is Kent Browning. I'm the Trails Program Director for the Austin Ridge Riders Mountain Bike Club. I am also a member of the Friends of Emalon Motorcycle Park, but I'm coming today as a concerned citizen of both the City of Austin and Travis County. The public access portion of the land management plan is up for review or up for update. And I would like to have a chance for the citizens, myself included, to have an input on that. Mr. Pontine recommended a methodology. I have no problem with that. I have no problem with a different methodology. I just like a chance for the public to review and comment on it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Ken. Stephanie Simmons. Okay. We'll get it. Thank you.
So hi, my name is Stephanie Simmons. I'm a citizen, just your ordinary citizen, I'd have to say. But I actually am, provided you with a map and a location of where my house is located, which is interesting because it's the same map that's currently up on the image here for anybody else to see. And you can see the pointer to get down cave. So I've been a member of this HOA since 2009, and when I acquired the property, this was the preserved property across from my house was privately owned by Lumbermans, which became Four Star. And I wanted to highlight that nobody has ever, ever followed through on the obligations that were put aside for this karst preserve. I listed on the documents I gave you the interim karst management agreement and the city ordinances that were put in place. So moving forward, I'd like to, last year the city acquired the property, and I'd like to understand how those are going to be satisfied. Because as you can see, I purchased this property for this preserve, and there's no one in the world that's any closer to get down cave than me. The other thing, when I first moved in, there was a cave day that was a great outreach opportunity that used to be through multiple organizations, and it raised awareness for the preserve. And that's actually part of the karst agreement that was set aside, but no one has done it in years. And the other thing, I've been working with the field manager out here to put in an ADA compatible bridge, the watershed field manager. There's a location within the trail itself that has a 4-foot rise right across the creek. And that creek bed, if we could get an ADA compatible bridge across that, that would be allow then anybody. And I have to say, I did this before I broke my leg, so that is not the impetus behind this. But if we could, I'm working with the city neighborhood partnering program on that. But I've brought up to Leah Gibson that I'd like to start a Friends Of for this property. It's a little bit different because it's a watershed management property, not a park. So if you guys can consider some way in which I can achieve that involving the neighbors and helping to maintain that property in the way it was first set aside and the way that it was tended to be. Thanks.
Thank you, Stan. Mm-hmm. Chris Fields.
Hi there. My name's Chris Fields. I'm a resident of the city of Austin and a user of one of the park areas that falls in your jurisdiction. Specifically, I'm along motorcycle riding trails. I've been enjoying that area for almost 20 years now, and I understand that there's consideration to potentially alter or change public access and use and guidelines and rules and regulations that might apply to this area. Having been involved over these 20 years in maintenance and upkeep of this property and these trails, I have some suggestions I'd like to be able to share with people that are giving us consideration. I've reviewed those documents, and I do have concerns with some of the language in there. There are some special needs for this particular riding area that I feel we need to inject some specific language to that effect. If there are workshops in the future, I very much would like to be able to share with you my knowledge help everyone involved better understand the special needs of this particular riding area with regard to trail access and, more importantly, documentation of the actual areas that we've established over the years and continue to maintain. So if the opportunity does arise, I very much would like to share my name and contact information to be able to possibly partake in that and help with the amendment of those guidelines.
Good. Thank you, Chris.
You're welcome.
Robert Corbin.
As you all know, when the BCC, Robert Corbin is my name. When the BCCP was established a few years ago, the city was under obligation to enforce the leash laws on the Greenbelt. And 2 years ago, I addressed y'all about the situation on the green belt with dogs off leash and how bad it was. The city has done some minuscule enforcement, and it's improved the situation somewhat. And I've periodically been going down to the green belt and monitoring the situation and even confronting people, which I did this morning from 10 to 11:30. On the trail in an hour and a half, I saw 25 dog poops and 8 dogs off leash. Two ended in, when I talked to the people, ended in confrontations with the people, and I was told that I should get off the green belt, which I kind of think is, you know, that I have a right to be on the green belt, and there are laws in place. And that's not unusual. If you all go down there and confront some of these people, you'll find out that some of them are very fascist, like fascist, about their dogs and their rights to have their dogs off leash. About a month ago, I did a similar talk and a similar walk, and a woman with two large dogs told me in the suggestive sense, maybe I shouldn't come to the green belt. What is so bad about dogs on the green belt besides poop washing into the creek, running people off the green belt because there are people that will not go there because they're afraid of dogs, and molesting people on the green belt, which I've had them attack me, jump on me, etc., all sorts of things? The answer, besides those three issues, is riparian destruction. And you can go out there and walk the green belt, and you can see for yourself the riparian destruction that the dogs are causing. I would say the riparian destruction is about 10% people and 90% dogs. And what happens, and I saw it this morning, they make new trails. The dogs get hot, they're off leash, they want to go to the water, they go down, and they go back and forth, and pretty soon you have a trail to the creek. And then what happens? More dogs use it. And then people start using it with their dogs off leash, and it starts spreading like a cancer. And you can see now, and I'd be glad to take any of you all down there and show you this riparian destruction that is slowly spreading along the green belt. Now, I'm not saying it's going to be tomorrow or next year or in 5 years, but you look 20, 30, 40 years out, if you don't get dogs off that green belt, you are going to have just a riparian urban ditch that has been totally destroyed, and it's by dogs. So I would like you to take the steps to ban dogs from our Barton Creek green belt, because whatever the city has tried, it does not work. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Corbin. Are there any other people that haven't signed up that would like to speak? Citizens communication? Before we go to number two, I'm not real sure whether it's, you know, Sherry's world or Kimberly's world to perhaps, you know, at least inform me. Council member may know this, but on both issues, number one, is there going to be a meeting between now and our December meeting for where people would have the opportunity to come and be part of the whole trail access part? And then number two, with what Mr. Corbin was talking about, I do recall, you know, when he came the first time. So I don't know, Sherry, whether that's you or whether it's Kimberly, but I mean, give me some response if you wouldn't mind.
To address your first question, item agenda number 5, we'll talk about the land management plan updates and review schedules. So I'll speak to that when we get to item 5, if that's okay.
That'd be great, Kimberly. Thank you.
Well, I'll just let you know, we co-manage the Barton Creek Greenbelt and the other tracks that are a part of the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve, but also they're managed as parks by the Parks and Recreation Department. So I can certainly take that message back to our Parks and Recreation Department colleagues. I know we've heard from Mr. Corbin before, and I know there are concerns about impacts of dogs, and the city park staff has tried to do additional ticketing and try to do additional work down there, but I know it is an ongoing problem.
Okay, well, and I'm aware of it as well, because I mean, I think it was right after Mr. Corbin was here the first time. I did go, And, you know, and I certainly witnessed, you know, what he's talking about. I certainly would understand that, you know, very strict monitoring is probably what it would take for quite a while for people to really learn that, you know, there is a leash law, and you really do need to comply. I mean, you know, we know what happens with citations. I mean, you know, some people pay a citation, say, well, fine. Some people don't even pay the citation. I mean, just collecting them is difficult. But, you know, obviously, Sherry, I think that, and if the county, you know, can help in any way, and if that's some sort of funding or whatever, I think we need to talk about it, because I don't think that it's going to get better. I mean, unless we really ratchet down what the real issue is. So,
yeah. Well, thank you. I mean, Barton Creek Greenbelt is certainly just an area that's being loved to death by Austin. So, you know, we're open to any and all suggestions for how to improve that.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Sure.
Okay. Let's go to number two, and that would be the approval record of decisions from the June 2nd, 2017 regular meeting.
I'll move approval.
And I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. That passes. Number three is the updated BCCP permit from U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Secretary?
Yes. So in your packet, you'll see there is an updated permit. The service sent this updated permit to me reflecting the BCCP secretary change from Willie to me. The service has also implemented a new HCP format. So some of the standard conditions are slightly different. They are now requiring that the permittee sign acknowledging that they understand and agree to the terms of conditions. It also now has two permit numbers. You'll notice up at the top, the first one's the old permit number. However, the old permit numbers didn't get moved into their new law enforcement's database, so the permit will have two numbers associated with it now. City of Austin's law team reviewed the permit and didn't see anything of note. It has the same conditions. It might just be shuffled around in a little bit of a different format. Travis County staff is reviewing it as well. Luella Roberts, who is the services environmental review in the environmental review division, said that the new permit is what the service would have previously called a minor amendment, but they don't call this kind of update an amendment anymore. So in the service's opinion, these changes shouldn't need approval by the full governing bodies like an actual permit amendment would. It's just updating the secretary's name and requiring some signatures. Mm-hmm. So the original permit listed the mayor and the judge. So you'll see here again the mayor and the judge listed. Mm-hmm. So the service will be having a member of their team sign it. They should be mailing me hard copies that I will then try to get the judge and the mayor's signatures from. I just wanted to give you a copy of the permit so you could see.
Okay.
Thanks.
So I don't believe there's an action item, just that you know, you approve this update, and then we can see what it takes to move forward to get the signatures from the judge and the mayor.
I guess my main issue would be ensuring that in fact there are no changes, that it is simply a renumbering or a reissuance of a permit number, and that all the elements that were in here, you said they may have moved them around a little bit.
Yes.
But if our law department reviewed it and said that there are no changes, whether substantive or cosmetic, and if the county attorney's office can also confirm that, then I think that we should then pursue getting the signatures from the mayor and the county judge. But I wouldn't want to do that before we had those assurances from both our legal teams.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thanks.
And I went through it as well and concluded the same with the City of Austin's legal. There's no changes to the substance of the permit. It's just shifted around for a new look, an updated look.
So you don't feel like that you need an approval from the committee? Would the signatures work, or would you be more comfortable if we were to make the motion?
I would be more comfortable, but because the service doesn't consider an amendment, there isn't a formal approval. Okay. But having your blessings to move forward to attain those signatures once we have county staff's input. So we've had city law, and we've had city and county BCP staff, and I believe we're waiting on county law to to take a look and weigh in on how they feel, whether it's an amendment or not. Yeah. Because if it is considered an amendment, then it would need to go to the full governing body for approval. But because there's no changes here, besides replacing my name with Willie's name, and then now actually asking for a permittee signature, those were the only two changes of note.
Sounds fine with me.
So, council member, would that be a motion by you?
Yeah, it doesn't sound like we need one, but if you would
but
like
you would
one,
rather have one.
I would be happy to make that motion.
And I would second that.
Great. Thank
and the motion favor. And the motion would include ensuring that the respective governing entities' legal staff have had sufficient review and can confirm that there aren't any substantive or cosmetic. Any changes are only cosmetic.
Great. And that's certainly acceptable by me. So all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. That passes. Thank
okay.
you.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Four is a letter from the coordinating committee to the BCP neighbors.
And I'd like to call Johanna Arndt to come on up. She is the BCP outreach staff with Travis County. And she can talk a little bit more about the origin of the letter and its intent. And you have a copy of the letter in your packet as well.
Mm-hmm.
Hi, so this letter is a letter going out electronically to folks around the preserve through Nextdoor and other social media outlets coming from the two coordinating committee members. I drafted it with input from staff from both city and county, and it is to educate folks about what the preserve is and the benefits of the preserve, as well as ways that they can be good neighbors to the preserve through not planting invasive plants, reporting trespassing, that sort of thing, to improve the preserve for everybody. So we present it to you here today to see if you would like to sign it, and then we can send it out to the community.
Council member, do you have a comment?
I think this was one of the action items that we talked about last fall, so I'm really glad that, that y'all have written the letter. I think it may help for people who live adjacent to or in close proximity to the Balcones Canyonland Preserve to understand what a good fortune they have to live nearby, but also what specific and tremendous responsibilities attach to that.
Yeah, Johanna, I'm pleased that we got this as well. I did just have one question about keeping the cats indoors. Is keeping the cats indoors because it attracts the coyotes and everything else? Or, I mean, what else happens with the cats indoors?
It's because the birds prey on birds and other wildlife quite a bit. They're actually, after habitat loss, they're the, I think, second largest negative impact to birds.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, I just didn't know whether that would offend anybody. I mean, if you're trying to tell people do what, you know, what they need to do with their animals. I mean, I think probably most cats, I mean, unless you're just really out in the country, mm-hmm. I mean, probably do stay indoors, but you know, you don't want something put in there that might tick somebody off, you know, so to speak. But I mean, I thought it was really well crafted, and I think it, you know, it sends the kind of message that, you know, that I wanted sent. But I mean, I guess somebody would tell us if they got offended about telling us what to do with their cats.
Can I add to that?
Well, come up and.
Yeah.
Come up to the microphone, Stephanie. You're still Stephanie.
Yes, I'm
Simmons,
still.
Right?
I'm still Stephanie Simmons, and actually, I know. We have had some coyotes within the preserve, and they behave naturally. And some of the concerns have been raised by people in the community that the coyotes are killing all the cats, you know. And so, we've had some coyote talks. We've had two. One actually we held in the preserve itself, and then we had one last week, September 11th, at the library. And part of what Adrian Clark was trying to highlight is that coyotes aren't the only killer of cats. It's also all these other things. So you can maybe leverage some of that information from her, because I had her send that to me to help just not blame the coyotes, because there's predatory birds, there's cars, there's other people taking them in. She just listed all this stuff. So maybe you'd like to reach out to Adrian, Ms. Clark, sure, and get that list. It'll help substantiate keeping cats indoors.
Sure, thank you for that suggestion. Yeah.
I think what we might do is maybe rather than just focusing on cats, because we also have dogs that may be off-leash, and that would also be... So the point is we want to not only protect the preserve, but also protect our domestic pets. Mm-hmm. And so maybe there's another way that you can reference it and make sure that it's not just focusing on cats.
Sure. Okay. And we could, if you would like, you know, remove that from this letter.
Maybe
and
so.
Maybe do a separate education campaign around those issues.
The native invasive plants is good, trespassing and dumping. Yeah, you may just be able to shorten that sentence. Mm-hmm. But give it some thought, and if there's a way to either be more inclusive or less specific, I think that'd be a good approach.
And then we can send it back to y'all's offices.
Well, that'd be great. I mean, I have a friend whose terrier got picked up by an owl.
Wow.
And flew him about 2 miles away, and then I guess dropped him.
Wow.
I mean, with all of this wildlife, it's pretty amazing as to what wildlife can, you know, deal with, you know, across the board.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't believe that until they showed me the little dogs, the puncture marks. Oh. I mean, where the dog had gotten picked up. So, but I think, hey, this is a great letter, and I think that this is something that the community needs to see, and I think it'll be well received.
Okay, great.
So nice job. I don't think there's any action. I mean, I think we're, you know, the fact that we've said this is something we want to do. So nice job, Joanna.
Thank you.
Yeah,
so I can
bring it back and we can sign it.
Yeah, I'll make that edit and bring it on back.
Thanks.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Number five is the BCP land management plan updates. Secretary?
Yes. So BCP staff right now is working on the public access and fire management tier 2 chapters. And I believe there's some confusion about the land management chapter structure. So we have a tier 1, which is the overview of the preserve and partner responsibilities. The tier 2 are just general land management guidelines, specific best management practices. And then tier 3 is when where we talk about land use on specific tracts. So the public access chapter, which we had several people come out to speak today, these updates are minimal. We were directed to incorporate the trail master plan into this chapter. Now the trail master plan has already been approved by the coordinating committee. It was approved on February 18th, 2009. You'll see in your packet a record of decision from that meeting. So there is no public comment on the trail master plan. It's been approved and that's done. You will see it as a appendix to the chapter now. And the majority of the chapter just restates the public access intent from the Habitat Conservation Plan that was established in 1996, which is not subject to revision as well. The most current copy of this draft has not changed any land use that was described in the current accepted 1999 public access chapter. There are no changes there. Staff is hoping to send the document for internal review to PARD, AFD next week. Then it will also be discussed at the Citizens Advisory Committee on October 24th. So there's one opportunity for the public to come speak. It will then be talked about and discussed at the Scientific Advisory Committee on November 1st. And then we'll bring it to the Coordinating Committee on December 1st. That's public access and fire management. And the Tier 2 chapters, like I said, are just very basic and general. If there were any changes to what's happening on the land, those would be reflected in the Tier 3.
Sounds like a good process.
You know, all the years that I've been on the BCP coordinating committee, this subject has probably garnered the most angst from folks. I mean, obviously there, you know, probably there may be more than two sides. And while I'm cognizant of what happened in 99, and I did know that the plan had gotten signed off in 2009 as well. I wasn't here in the 2009 period, which, you know, doesn't make any difference. But given the fact that there is an opportunity, it sounds like October the 24th and November the 1st.
Yes.
Those two dates are going to be the times to voice your concerns. I mean, I see some head shaking. So I'm willing to take a comment or two about why that wouldn't be, because it sounds like to me that that's really the place to do it and the time to get it done. And if you can provide enough information, we'll come on down, Tomas.
And it will be posted publicly online in advance of that October 24th meeting. So there will be an opportunity to review it.
Certainly we're talking about a document that we haven't read. Okay. So we don't know what's going to be in it. The philosophy is that
just one sec. I think that what Kimberly and also the commissioner was saying is the document is the same one that was approved in 09. So that document is in fact available publicly at this time.
I don't see the damage of us reading it. What I was getting into is that when the permit was signed, which is the small 10-page document, and then the big fat book with all the guidelines, everything after that is supposed to follow that big document and interpretations of it. So I don't see, I mean, as a citizen, I should see why this would be so bad for us to be able to review what happens on that. I'm sure some things are going to be changed. If not, minimum, then it's fine. But let us have the opportunity. The problem with the Citizens Advisory Committee is it is not really a representation of the stakeholders. It's a group made for people that have some being elected by a staff. It's not like a board of in the Austin City Council where each council member sends a representative. I have been coming here for 4 years, I guess, and my difficulty is that there's no an appeal process in the entire system. In fact, the City of Austin, because they have this thing, having a city manager, there's no appeal process guarantee for any citizen. So the only thing we can do is to be proactive and come here even before the document comes up and say, listen, let us look at it and have comments. I don't see a damage to it. If you don't find our comments to be relevant, then just set it aside, but at least give us that opportunity.
Well, don't you think, Tomas, I mean, not to interrupt you, but don't you think that you're going to have that opportunity on the 24th of October and November the 1st? I mean,
sincerely, sir, I have many times seen a report given to you very different than what the things that happen in those meetings. And being able to speak on 3 minutes on the citizens' communications is very difficult with such a complex case. The case that I've been working on, that is no secret, which is a motorcycle park, we have a series of problems, and we can never address them because we have only 3 minutes at a time. So maybe this is the first time where we could say, well, listen, we find these issues, please address them. And we would like to bring them to you and not to staff. I'm being very sincere and as candid as possible about it.
Well, you can still do that.
In which format do you suggest?
It would need to be in writing. We would need to have your information in writing, and what you should do is take the plan that's available and make your comments on that and edit that and tell us how you think it should be revised or rewritten. I think that would be the most straightforward way and the most efficient way for you to communicate what you don't like about the existing plan so that we can then have your recommended changes in hand.
I like this dialogue, this format better, actually, because you may have some, I may say, for example, why are you doing this? And you say, we're doing this for that. I don't think that it takes that much time. These meetings are normally only 2 hours long. This document, the land, public access, as you said, and I've watched all the tapes, it has been a big deal during the entire process. The trail master plan, which is approved by I think it was Leffingwell and another lady, has nothing in it. If you read it, it doesn't have any guidelines. It leaves everything to the director's discretion, unless. So let's look at that document also. Why not? I mean, it's taken 10 years since this board directed staff to rewrite the document for this to happen. What is so bad about looking at it? And given that we don't have any kind of appeal process.
We're talking about the 2009 master plan. Was that Commissioner Huber and Mayor Leffingwell?
Yes.
Okay. Listen, I mean, I am always open to listening to a rational request. I do realize that it can be perceived as, you know, that it's against you for the changes that you might want to make. I mean, I certainly have proven to a number of y'all that I'm willing to go out there, walk it, ride it. I mean, by myself, with y'all. I do understand your desire here for there to be some changes in that. And is there a mechanism by which, you know, we could look at what was signed off on in 2009? No, perhaps we won't get anywhere there because we're only two of us, and you got to vote one way. Or
it's the same document.
It's the same document.
You're talking about the trail master plan. The trail master plan you're talking about.
Yes.
So
okay.
The trail master plan is an appendix now, or will be at this next revision, an appendix of the public access chapter.
Okay.
The trail master plan was already approved, and I believe if we were to change that document, it may be considered a permit amendment. There was language written in there at the time that specifically says that. So as far as I'm concerned, that document, it has been approved, and it stands.
Then let me ask, Adam, is that, in your opinion, I mean, and if you say I need to study it a little bit longer, would that, I mean, if there's any change to that, does that necessitate something that could be very detrimental to the permit?
I would want to look at it.
Yes.
I think it all matters of what I suspect, Gerald, is that the issue would be is how much of a change.
Okay.
And looking at the thresholds for permit amendments and you know, where's some flexibility versus triggering an amendment.
You obviously know, Tomas, that, I mean,
I have a point.
If there is something that triggers, you know, an issue with a permit, then that's not going to happen. I mean, I'm not going to do it if it's going to create and cause that.
That's exactly my point, that once it's approved, like she said, that it's stamped, it's very difficult to tinker with it. So why don't we take a little bit more time before we approve it so we're happy with it? That's the point I'm trying to make. Go ahead.
There was an extensive public comment period in the creation of the Trail Master Plan for over a year, several meetings, several opportunities, several edits of comments incorporated. The final plan was presented and accepted by the committee. There was time there.
I'm actually no objecting to the Trail Master Plan. My only criticism of the Trail Master Plan, it doesn't have any guidelines. It talks about philosophically, but it doesn't say you need to build a trail this way or another. And so that's the only comment that I would have about the Trail Master Plan. I'm talking about the land, the entire philosophy of public access. And as you said, it's so difficult once it's stamped and sealed by all the parties that be. It has to go to City Council. It has to go to the Commissioner's Court for approval also. Why not to look at it before? I mean, it was the first one was done in 1999. In 2007. You guys didn't like it. The board didn't like it and told them to fix it again. I'm sorry if I'm using plain language. And it has taken 10 years to come back. And it's going to be probably another 10 years. The city was just getting so big, nobody can deal with little things anymore. Mm-hmm. We don't have an appeal process. So why not look at it before and leave us an opportunity? If you don't like our comments, you have the right not to take them.
Then I would suggest that you put those in writing. I'm just telling you, Tomas, what I'm trying to read this tea leaf.
Sure.
I'm willing to look at them. I would go to the 24th. I would go to the first meeting, and I would plead, you know, your case, and see if there can be, you feel like that there's any traction there. I don't know how long, Adam, it would take for you and your organization to opine on whether that would create, you know, an issue with the permit itself. It may not go anywhere, but you ought to be offered, even though, hey, this has been going on 10, 12 years,
before
15 years, I mean, ever since
day.
I've been part of it. And it's pretty obvious that it's really difficult to push on it. Now, whether that's because, I mean, this is the way it is and that's what it's going to be, I don't know. But, I mean, I've fought enough fights to, at some point in time, know when to raise the flag and go, it's taking too much time. I mean, I'm not going to get there. I do think that reasonable requests should be handled reasonably. But all I can tell you is what I just said. That's what I would do. Whether we're going to get anywhere with it or not, I don't know. But I'd sure as a heck show up on the 24th and the 1st. And put in writing what it is that you think we need.
So what is the schedule that you propose? And you're proposing that this document be to the open to the public on such a date, and how much time do we have to be prepared to respond to you? What is the proposed schedule? And do we respond to you, or do we respond to staff?
Well, I think the schedule is what we have laid out. I mean, we've got a 24th of October, a 1st, and then it's going to come back to us on December the 1st.
Yes, correct.
So that's the schedule. May we
expand it? What happens a lot is that we don't have the staff. I mean, in my experience with soil issues that I'm not talking about right now, it takes us a little bit longer. We don't have the staff. Could we postpone it till the next time this board meetings? It's taken 10 years to do it, 10 years and a month. It's not much more.
The document is the same one that's been out there since 2009, so it's nothing new, and you have the document available. What I would urge you to do, rather than arguing the point here, is to start working on the pieces that you would like to see amended, and then state your case to the Citizens Advisory Committee and the Scientific Advisory Committee. Tomas, that is the process. I am not willing to change the process. It's not fair.
So it's not fair to whom?
It's not fair to the public, because you are here making this you're making this request, and I would not be willing to grant one request where we haven't noticed it to the entire city of Austin so that they can come in and make whatever additional requests that they might like to have. So we have a process in place, and I would urge you to follow it.
No, this will be open to the public. The only thing I'm asking for is a little more time. I'm agreeing to do it in writing like you suggested. I'm agreeing to do everything you're suggesting. The only thing I'm asking is for a little more time, so we have to be able to do the work.
We don't know yet, Tomas, that we don't have enough time. So December 1st is when the next time this board will meet, and that's more than 2 months from now.
When is the document going to be available to me to read?
I think
it's online now.
No, it's a revised.
The trail master plan is online.
It's going to be exactly the one from 1999?
It'll be the exact one that was approved in 2009. The trail master plan is just an appendix now.
I'm talking about the land management plan. I'm not talking about the trail master plan.
Chapter. So the public access chapter, I looked at the 2007 version, and it was, in my opinion, a bit overinflated. So what we have done is go back to the basics. As staff members, we've pulled out everything that the original Habitat Conservation Plan from 1996 describes for public access goals. The new public access chapter that will be out for review minus the Trail Master Plan appendix is less than 20 pages. Out of those 20 pages, four or five are verbatim language from the Habitat Conservation Plan. So there is not much to review, and the majority of the rest of the pages are exactly as it's written in 1999, our current and approved plan, which is out there right now as well.
Councilmember Poole, as you stated, the document has been changed.
Well, I think that...
Not the Trail Master Plan.
No, I'm not talking about the Trail Master Plan, so I'm talking about the Chapter 12.
I don't see any benefit in having an argument about this here. Kimberly can email you links to all of the documents or give you a PDF copy by email of all of the documents this afternoon when she gets back to her office, and then you will have time to look through them and give us your comments in writing, please.
If this is not a place to have these discussions and this friendly talk, and there is not in any other place, I'm sorry, but she's talking about rewriting the document. She's talking about changing the document. And again, I'm talking about Chapter 12, not about the Trail Master Plan. Thank you.
Thanks, Tomas.
I'll send that email to you.
Else on five?
No, that's it.
Can we stop?
If you'll come down here, I'm going to give you one question to clarify this, and everybody needs to listen to what needs to be said.
I was trying to follow that.
I know it's difficult. So, your question is.
So, I'm a simple-minded guy here. It sounds like you're taking a packet and you're giving it to some other folks for review. And I'm asking, is this information that you're planning to send Tomas the exact same information that you're sending to the other folks for review?
What I will be sending to Tomas today are links to the currently approved Trail Master Plan and the 1999 public access chapter. What will be released and posted publicly in about 2 weeks will be the staff's first draft at the rewrite of the public access chapter. We're talking about two things. There's a public access chapter. There was the Trail Master Plan. We were directed to incorporate the approved Trail Master Plan into the public access chapter. So that's really what this version is the Trail Master Plan is now becoming an appendix to the public access chapter.
Okay, so we're just particularly sensitive because of past history, and I'm trying to make sure that if changes are being made to these governing documents, that we get a chance to actually see what the changes are at the same time the rest of the group is, so that we get a chance to perhaps give decent feedback that means something. Because in the past, what's happened is the change comes and we get a minute or two to say, gee, this doesn't work. And everybody says, well, that's too bad. It's already done. We're moving on. So I'm just trying to make sure we understand.
All the documents are public, and they'll be up on the website. Everybody who is here today who spoke on it, Kimberly can email the same information to everyone and then put it easily accessible on the Travis County website, and we can post it. Well, I guess it's the Balcones Canyonland Preserve page.
Yes.
That's at both the county side and the city side. So the information has to be the same for everybody. We can't operate any other way. There are no secret documents. We operate
That's all I was trying to make sure is we're getting the same thing they are.
It's a public process. Yep. That literally means the public. It's not this group in the public or us or some other group. It's everybody, which is why we can't change the process for one person either. We can only make changes that affect everybody.
Within a couple of weeks, then, Kimberly,
you
all will have that out, and everybody will have it at the same time in the exact same thing.
Absolutely. And please do comment. Give us your thoughts.
Okay.
Thank you. Thanks. Number six is current events, and we start with the infrastructure workshop on October 13th.
Yes, so the city and county come together to host an BCCP infrastructure workshop. It was every year, but now we're doing it every other year as we start building our online training as well to supplement that. It is a free half-day workshop geared toward infrastructure project managers and field crews. It provides an opportunity to learn about the BCP, how to navigate through the infrastructure mitigation process, how to work in sensitive habitats, and provides corridor considerations for vegetation maintenance and oak wilt prevention. It's a well-attended workshop. It'll be held at the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center, and there is an optional cave tour after that event, and we provide breakfast, and we're really excited. We look forward to that event. The next thing I'd like to just mention is that I have a meeting on October 11th coming up with the City of Austin's Development Services Department's Environmental Review staff. I'll be meeting with their managers and staff members from the Watershed Protection Department's Environmental Review. Sue Barnett, who's the manager of Environmental Review for Development Services, mentioned that she has new staff since I last spoke with that group. So I'll be giving a BCCP refresher presentation. We're also going to be offering Development Services a one-page BCCP FAQ sheet that they can hand to people that come in to...
And the letter.
Yes, and the letter. That would be a great idea. So we're going to talk about just some process improvements, better education to the public when they come in and talk to Development Review. In addition to the general BCCP participation education information, where I'm also working with that group, and we're trying to determine if permit procedures in relation to projects approving ESA compliance has changed between the issue of the permit and now. We had a speaker, I want to say probably about a year ago, come in and talk about how he had to show that he participated before he could get that building permit. However, Section 1 of the key concepts of the BCCP Shared Vision, Section 8, states that private sector participation is voluntary. There's no mandated requirements to develop under the Regional 10A permit, and that landowners and developers in Travis County may apply at any time to the service for individual 10A permits, and that BCCP permit holders will not condition any local development approval or permit upon an applicant participating in the BCCP. However, landowners are encouraged to use the mitigation measures that will contribute to the completion of the already defined preserve system. So it does say in our permit that we cannot withhold those development permits. However, we've heard several times now that there must have been something different in the process at Development Services before. So we're really just trying to figure out, was there anything different? What has changed? And how can we better coordinate? So we've started that dialogue, and we're working on trying to get that. There's been some confusion there, so we're trying to straighten that out.
Let us know what you find.
I will. I will give an update on that meeting at the next meeting, at our next meeting. And that's all I have to say. Yep.
Okay. Number seven, we're going to have a status update on the BCP permit caves and cave issues. Nico?
Thank you. I'm Nico Howard, Program Manager for the Balcones Canyonland Preserve on the City of Austin side. And the caves are a very core issue for the BCP permit. And we've fallen behind in some aspects of our caves, so I'm needed to be more diligent in improvements on the caves. And so I wanted to give you a status on some of the larger, more important caves that that we have problems with. We have projects to try to, you know, improve the situation on those. So let me start off Village of Western Oaks. So we have 62 permit caves that are preserved to ensure that the species, the rare cave invertebrate species, would survive. So one of the 62 caves is Get Down Cave at Village of Western Oaks Karst Preserve. So back in the 1990s, you know, I got to show the developer's geologist the caves on his property. The developer is scratching his head saying, what do I do with all these caves in this area? We worked with them to put a cave preserve in Village of Western Oaks, and we kind of envisioned it as being a great opportunity to get the public, you know, together with cave species and protect them as well. So back in 1998, these are conceptual drawings of the karst preserve at Village of Western Oaks. And it pretty much looks like that now. So it's pretty much in place. It's been very lucky that what we were hoping for is the citizens would get on board who lived in the area and adopt it. And it was seen as an amenity by the neighborhood association. They put on their website. Some of the great neighbors like Ms. Simmons, who spoke during citizens' comment, you know, she's been out there putting up signs that have fallen down. She's been educating the neighbors about how to get rid of fire ants with boiling water rather than pesticides, distributing native plants, maintaining the preserve. So we're very lucky to have citizens like that who have been participating in it. So, the neighbors have had lots of concerns over the years, including wildfire issues, you know, that are valid. Wildfire issues, how do I get rid of these noxious weeds on my property, maybe without using pesticides? The trail, how do you maintain the trails and things like that, so forth. Wanting to get in the caves. We had, for several years, we had a cave day, and more than 1,000 people came out, got to go into the caves, not the permit caves, but we have other caves out there as well. And so what happened last June of last year in 2016 is that the city finally acquired the preserve. It went to Watershed Protection Department. And so we've been talking with him about doing active management for the cave preserves according to the BCP permit, which hasn't happened yet, but we met in July, and we're meeting again next week with them and hoping that we can move forward. We're offering to help do that because we have staff that can do the final surveys. The caves need some restoration before they're really safe for the public to go into, and the watershed has done some minor improvements on the caves, but they need a lot of work. Watershed has been working a lot on a water quality pond that's associated with the preserve site, and it's a leaking pond for a decade, so they've got a $700,000 project to improve the pond, and so we're lucky about that as well. That's the status there on Get Down Cave. I gotta switch slides. Let me move over to here. One of our other large BCP caves is Flint Ridge Cave. And as you all know, there's a, can y'all hear me on this? Okay.
Is that the MOPAC expansion? What is that first slide?
So the first slide is showing you the SH-45 right-of-way, which is pretty much over the portion of it that's over Flint Ridge Cave. And as you all may know, that for the last few years, we've been doing some studies to understand the sensitivity of Flint Ridge Cave to the area. And we find that, the surface is really well connected to some of the drips in the cave. And so we're continuing the monitoring to kind of better understand how the construction that is going on over the cave might impact the cave. And what we're seeing is, some of the drips visually, are showing a lot of sediment, so forth, not the whole cave, but some of the drips in there. Next week, I'm gonna have a team go in there and take some photographs. We've got all the drip gauges going, because if you do a core in the right of way, it could cause, potentially a flow route to go down the core hole instead of the drip it used to go. So we wanna better understand. And then if there is a impact scene, then we hope we can try to remedy it as best we can.
So when do you know you're at a place where you need to raise a red flag to halt construction or bring it to TxDOT's attention, mm-hmm. or any of that?
It's kind of untrod territory, right? Because even to be able to detect impacts, it's kind of a challenge. But we are, taking water samples, doing drip monitoring, continuously on some of the drips. As we see sediment, we're trying to collect samples, but being able to trace it to an exact source definitively, it might be challenging. It could be that some of the drips in the cave might be impacted, maybe not all of them. So we're kind of in new territory there as far as trying to fix something that's directly over the cave. It'll certainly be a challenge, even to understand and do enough monitoring to actually to understand the impacts and what's the cause and how to fix it.
Have you talked with TxDOT or anybody, or is this just something that you're talking about on staff?
Right, no, we now? Have not talked with TxDOT about it yet.
Is there a reason why you haven't at least let them know that it looks like there may be some issues?
Uh-huh. One of my staff had just told me on Thursday, and so yesterday.
Okay.
And so I haven't had time to even get photographs to respond. So we're still in the process of investigating. It looks to them like unusual sediment in one of the springs, in one of the cave drips, which through tracing we've seen is very sensitive to the surface in that area. So we haven't had time to even evaluate yet. And the, just also, you know, we are collecting drip data, and certainly it'll be a while before we can actually analyze the data. We've collected water samples periodically. You know, we haven't had time to look at that to analyze. We're probably going to collect more samples next week, and then it'll probably take at least 2 weeks to get lab results and then for us to be able to analyze the data.
Do you have a process where you would normally let the state know that this is happening and that you have concerns and that you're monitoring it and following it so that they understand that there are some of these effects that may be damaging to the cave, which then affects our permit, which is the whole issue that we've been concerned about having that work and the extension of SH 45 in the first place?
I think the big challenge then is to be able to have data that we can even talk about, you know, real data other than someone telling me something that they saw. So we're still in the aspect of that. No, it's fairly untrod territory as far as being able to document damages in a cave from a surface impact.
I guess what I would like to say is please have some protocol established so that once you have the data, that you can easily and timely present it to the state, and also Fish and Wildlife needs to be aware that you are seeing some negative impacts, because if this is happening and you're able to collect the data to show that there is some damage happening, we need to know that as soon as possible in order to limit and mitigate whatever damage may ensue.
Yeah, Councilman Poole, Commissioner Dyer, Daryl Slusser with Austin Water. We will set up a process where we get this information to TxDOT and anybody else involved or concerned with.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Nico, I know since we're talking about the relationship as to what it might have to 45 Southwest, I know that we have the environmental engineer from the RMA, and he's here, and he might. You want to come up and say what is being done, what is taking place? This is perhaps the most sensitive road that perhaps has ever been built. I mean, it's taken longer than the other road that I know of. But why don't you introduce yourself and tell us?
Sure, my name's Kemble White. I'm a karst geologist, worked on the project from the TxDOT phase through to the CTRMA phase. I've been working on it, I think, for about 5 years straight at this point. I'm certainly happy to look at any data that come out of the study. I'm not sure, as Commissioner Dougherty stated, we've had a regular succession of site meetings during the development process involving the Barton Springs District, involving city staff, involving TCEQ, involving pretty much anybody who knows, you know, a significant amount about karst in the area. And I think the if you look at the reports that are put together by the Barton Springs Edwards Aquifer Conservation District staff and by the there is an independent environmental commissioning agent on the project, I think overall the collective impression is that commitments have been kept, that this has indeed been executed as, you know, perhaps the cleanest road on the planet. We have had a hurricane. We have had big rain events. You know, there are situations where, you know, eventualities occur. You know, but this is, as Nico said, this is kind of a new thing. It's a very difficult technical challenge to try to trace moisture from one spot to another. So I'm perfectly, you know, looking forward to seeing whatever data come out of this. I'm a little curious. The photo with the runoff, is that, which part of the project is that? Do you remember?
It is directly across, so Flint Ridge would be in that woods over there. So it's directly across from it, pretty much, the entrance of the cave. It would be on the west side of the right-of-way.
Can I ask
it's from
question?
The edge of the right-of-way looking.
Are you saying that when there are big rains, we can expect it to pollute the cave? You said there will be big rain events.
You're asking me?
Right, no, I'm asking him.
Oh, okay.
Well, whenever there's a rain, water quality drops in whatever water body you're talking about, because there's whether you're on developed land or undeveloped land, there's E. coli, there's sediment, big rains produce runoff, big rains produce things that can be, you know, sediment is a contaminant. So yeah, I guess that's the answer to the question.
But you mean different, it'll be different with the road there, though, is what you're saying, than before?
That's not what I'm saying. What I was commenting on initially was on any site, any construction site, when you have a big rain, there is runoff. The BMPs in general on this project have performed the way that they should. The couple of instances that I'm aware of, and I'm not aware of all of them, but the couple instances where a few of the BMPs have been overcome were well south of Flint Ridge. I think there was an issue down at Little Bear Creek that was jumped on pretty quickly. So that comment was just generally, you know, on any construction site, you get big rains, unforeseen things occur.
Okay. If you have any more questions, I got a bunch more in this update.
Okay. Did I answer your question?
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Let me see the next slide here. Okay. So Blow and Sink is one of our longest, deepest cave. It actually goes 240 feet down to the water table. We've actually seen Barton Springs salamander in the cave stream down below. I worked for Watershed. We had a large restoration project on the surface starting in 2013. And just before we got the permit to do the work, which would have helped put the runoff into the caves, they were kind of plugged, so they weren't going where they're supposed to go, and they were pummeling Flint Ridge, Blow and Sink with runoff. So the October 2013 flood pummeled Blow and Sink before we were able to make the improvements, which we have made those now. But here, the cave has been filled about mid-level. You can see the, looks like a little hourglass midway down with a bunch of rocks filling in, currently impassable. So since 2016, we haven't been able to get down to the water table. We've lost a significant amount of volume accessible to it. A lot of the fauna that we do surveys on is down below. The Barton Springs salamander is down below. If we trace to this to see what areas feed to it, we can't do that while it's plugged. And so the project we have is to bore a shaft down that we can take the rocks out so we can open the access again. And that hasn't been done yet, but we have the contract. We're hoping to start in October to open a shaft that's going to be airtight, watertight, allow us to pull the rocks out of the obstruction there and provide access to the water table. And we do have the funding for it, and we're moving forward with this project probably in October.
And how long has that obstruction been there? What was the date of that?
October 2013.
Okay. Wow.
October 2013. So it's been several years that we've have not had access to the lower area of the cave. And it's a significant amount of volume of, you know, if you take probably a lot of the caves we own, you could squeeze probably 80-90% into this one cave. It has such large volume, and it's very, very significant cave for a permit, so we need to restore it.
I'd be interested in you coming back, you know, at each of our meetings and giving us updates on
okay.
this, and then also I'd be very interested in a report back once you clear the obstruction to see what the state of the cave, what is it called, Northumberland, is that what it's called, that cave is called, and then the Liverpool
yep.
pit, and the dark side of the moon?
Yeah.
What is that?
It's a passage to the water table. So there you have the water you're actually at the water table of the aquifer at that point. There's water pouring through there. Northumberland is a passage I found back in 95 when we were trying to dig through the rocks one day and we found it. And one of the other things, there's other caves are, you know, 800 feet away from this one, but in the underground, they're only about 65 feet from overlapping with, for example, Northumberland or Oblivion Dome, which doesn't show in this diagram, which is near the water table. So we may actually be able to connect to this cave from other caves on the site, is what we're hoping to do as well.
Thank you.
And increase the habitat that we have here.
Yeah.
Nico, is Blowing Sink, is it the one that's off of Brody?
Mm-hmm.
It's Brody and...
Brody and Slaughter.
Brody and Slaughter.
That's right.
How is it that all of the road construction and everything that's right on this cave. I mean,
right.
I mean, there is there is nothing apparently that took place before the permitting of the roads and all of the things, because there are caves all out here in this area and all of these roads. How did that happen? I mean, with the city of Austin, I mean, being as diligent as they are about anything that's anywhere near a sinkhole, a cave.
I think one of the things is we're getting a better understanding. We've been doing tracing now. And so, for example, this cave stream we've traced from the Wildflower Center. You might remember there was a wastewater spill at La Crosse and Mopac, and we detected some wastewater constituents in here shortly thereafter. You know, so it was certainly impacted by things far away. So before 1996, 97, there was a concept that water moved really slowly. It took years to flow, and so we have a much different concept now. And that's when the codes, you know, were written back, you know, SOS was in 1992, for example. So we're getting a better scientific understanding. And one of the things we're certainly seeing is that there are many, many field caves across the whole area. And these are a heritage for the citizens, potential habitat for the karst invertebrates to protect. And so we're putting a lot of effort into opening up more of the caves that have been filled in. And they're all over the place, like you said. Exactly right.
So the Wildflower Center itself could have been, a contributor to something like this.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Exactly right. Another project kind of related to it is along Mopac South. We have a few of our permit caves. They're smaller caves. Slaughter Creek Cave, one of the 62 permit caves, and we're doing an excavation project in there, a restoration project. That was filled in. That cave was filled in during the construction in the 1990s of Mopac, and they filled it in. We're re-excavating it again. And trying to understand the extent of the cave and before, particularly if there's going to be an underpass made in Mopac, they might encounter part of it. So we're trying to get a better understanding before their potential impacts. You know, so it's a restoration project we're doing on that one. So the next one I'm going to is Go Cave, and we're doing when Davis Lane had coming across there for a realignment. It cut off some of the access that used to be able to park in front of the preserve. Again, it's a park that a lot of the neighbors adopted and they really cherish it. So we're trying to restore some of the access. We have a new sign that Save Barton Creek Association put out there. We had an open house a few months ago. We took people into Goat Cave to show them. One of the caves that you see near the entrance of it is called Wade Cave. And back in the 1980s, when I saw this cave, it was full to the brim with trash and bale wire. And so that's been pulled out, and we've had some projects since 2013 to excavate some of the ranch fill that's mixed in with glass. And from the cave, you can see how it looked about, this was about 2014, I guess, is how this looked. But one of the problems is that the educators can't use it because it's got this pit going down in there. So just today I took this picture of the steps we're putting in there to make it safe, both that the public won't fall into it, but then also the educators can step down with the kids and show them into the cave. And the cave has a fair amount of space in there, but a lot of it's just filled with still ranch fill, as you can see. That's Yasmin Avila there in the cave, and a lot of fill mixed in with glass and trash. So we're hoping to excavate a lot of that too and make it more suitable for education and make some more habitat while we're doing it. Well, it's that project. One of the other things going on is that TxDOT is looking at a Farm Road 2222 to 620 bypass, and we're kind of really happy about that because for years we're looking at a possibility of having an overpass going through the intersection, which is taking it very near one of our very rare caves, Tooth Cave, which is a very treasure to the BCP. It's got such biodiversity in that cave, even though it's just a one-room cave. But this bypass would potentially take it away from that intersection, and it seems to make sense as far as taking traffic smoothly away from that area. So we've been meeting with TxDOT. We've been doing assessments on our property, which come nearly adjacent to that area, to find the springs on them, measure the flow, measure the water quality of them as well.
Where is that again, Nico?
2222 and 620.
Four points.
One of our tracks is called Cortania, which is River Place. Yeah. So if you know River Place Boulevard, that's what we're talking about in that area. And the bypass would go along a power line and avoid the intersection where some of our really rare caves are. And we're also evaluating on our properties and seeing if there are caves there that we haven't fully identified in the past. So we have been finding those, and we're hoping to open those up too and evaluate them better.
And what's the bypass for?
To take the traffic from 2222 to 620 and round it without having to go through the intersection of 2222-620. I should have brought a map, I'm sorry.
But it's a 90-degree turn right there versus the bypass exactly keeps the traffic and the flowability, everything coming from Steiner and Lakeway. Right. Mm-hmm. It's been, you know, on the drawing board for some time now. Uh-huh. I think the city of Austin, part of the $720 million mm-hmm. bond, has some money that could be appropriated for that. I know that Commissioner Shea is very interested in seeing this bypass.
I don't think the $720 million bond, mobility bond, has, is this out in Travis County or is this in the
city? No, this is in North Austin, kind of near Lake Travis, 2222 at 620, so that's called Four Points. And there's River Place. What else is out there?
I think there's a little money. And I mean, Daryl, do you know that? And there's a little money out of the $720 million bond that was going to be perhaps augmented with all of the players?
We had a list of all the projects in the ordinance that we passed, so that if it's named in there, then the bond money can be used for it. But if it's not named in there, then it can't be used for
I think Councilmember Poole's probably more familiar with that.
Okay, all right. Well, I didn't mean to put you on the spot.
And there is some discussion about some more land purchases in the in the upcoming bond issue. Mm-hmm. There's also been, while I'm up here, there's also talk that we should coordinate with Travis County on what y'all have got in your bond package and what we might put in there. That would, of course, be more in Councilmember Poole's court.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And I think Texas, just in, you know, looking at the possibility at this point, they're not, I don't think there's a serious proposal yet on it, so that.
Yeah, because I don't remember any discussions where we would partner with TxDOT to do a bypass out at 2222 and 620. It may be happening, but as far as the mobility bond discussions, I don't remember that piece.
Okay, anyway. And it doesn't actually cross BCP property or even directly adjacent to it. You know, there's a private preserve that's River Place that's in between the proposed highway.
Okay.
And the LCRA, I think there's LCRA right away in there with all the electric lines.
Right. LCRA power line. That's right. So one of the last items then is that Code Next, we had provided some comments for Code Next, which are attached. So one of the things that we want hopefully fixing is that, you know, I mentioned to you so many filled caves across the area. And the city code actually makes it difficult to restore those caves. And so I made some suggestions. We met with some watershed staff about that. They thought they can incorporate it, you know, that would allow the cave restoration, that could facilitate it. You know, it's we consider it more of a maintenance activity than a construction activity. But I guess it's seen as a construction activity to restore a feature. And one of the other problems we saw in the code is that, for example, if you want to have a cave for education, you can't actually have a trail going to it. It's prohibited by code. So I guess you have to catapult the kids into the cave or something, you know. So we hopefully fixing some of those, you know, these issues with Code Next that would both help to allow us to restore caves widespread. And not much cave restoration has been going on, but partly because it is very difficult to permit that construction activity, you know. And certainly we want to promote cave education, so and also to restore caves. If we're going to clear fill out of a cave, you know, yeah, we'll have a trail going to the cave. So so those are some things we met with some of the watershed staff about, and they seem to be pretty much in agreement about the.
Who did you meet with?
Well, we met with David Johns, Scott Hires.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks, Nico.
And that's the end of my report, unless y'all have any questions.
Thank you. Number eight is a report from the Scientific Advisory Committee. Do we have someone here, or we're going to have the
yes.
secretary do that?
Today we have Craig Farquhar. He's the co-chair of the SAC. He's here to give an update. Come on up, please, Craig.
Hello, good afternoon. Craig Farquhar, the vice chair of the Scientific Advisory Committee, studying in for Dr. Jean Critcher. Just to give a brief update on our 9 August meeting of the Scientific Advisory Committee, go over a few of the highlights. A couple of them I won't discuss because they've either already been discussed or will be discussed more fully. Nico's presentation on the caves has already obviously been done, and then there will be discussion also, I think, on the guidelines to the Scientific Advisory Committee to update those, and I think Kimberly's going to talk about that.
Yes.
So just a couple of things then. First, there were elections for the chair and vice chair of the Scientific Advisory Committee, and the committee saw fit to unanimously re-elect Dr. Krecha and myself as chair and vice chair, respectively. And then there was an issue that came about for in the bird section, bird world. In early August, basically a week before, or the week prior to our 9 August meeting, I received an email from Mexican colleagues that deal with golden cheek-bore bird on the winter range. And they had noticed, just perusing the BirdLife International website, and BirdLife International is the body that sort of ranks, it's in charge of ranking the status for birds for the International Union of Conservation of Nature, IUCN, which is the global, highly sought after and highly utilized body for status of species on the planet. And so you've noticed that they had decided to, without any announcement, go over the status of the golden cheek warbler. And based on a couple of documents, decided that it should be probably downlisted to least concern. Right now it's critically endangered. And so it was thought that it should be reduced to least concern. And this was news to all of us. This of course, you know, we have the Fish and Wildlife that we abide by, but the IUCN was sort of taking it upon themselves to reassign the status of the golden cheek warbler based on a couple documents. So it alerted us to get into action, try to do something. We decided to put together, I sent an email to the coordinator for BirdLife and asked him to, because they're thinking about having their decision final within a few days. And we talked him out of doing that. And in the meantime, we were going to send them information to, you know, current information dealing with the status. The City of Boston put together a really nice package for the breeding range. And I'm working with the colleagues in Mexico to put together something similar for the winter range to update them on the actual status. So hopefully that issue will be put to rest. But we also decided that we should talk something about the recent lawsuit filed on behalf of the General Land Office by the Texas Public Policy Foundation to delist the warbler. We thought we should just discuss that. So we decided to form a subcommittee to look at the science one of the claims was that the science was not fully reviewed or not adequately reviewed. So we were going to, you know, take it upon ourselves to look over those documents once again and maybe be some sort of, you know, support for the Fish and Wildlife decision, the standing that the previous attempt to delist had been denied. So we were going to look into that. But recently, on September 11th, it turns out the Fish and Wildlife itself decided to to initiate a motion to dismiss the lawsuit based on some fairly, seems like me not being a lawyer, fairly straightforward claims that primarily boil down to critical habitat. And so it, the idea was that the claims in the motion say that they don't really have standing for that because of lack of subject matter jurisdiction for assessing critical habitat because of a statute of limitations that's run out. And then also with regard to the idea that the scientific findings were not adequately reviewed, that they found there was no standing for that because assessment or review of the scientific data was not required for the 90-day finding. And then further, they're saying that there were claims under NEPA that weren't addressed, but NEPA is not something that, apparently is not something that needs to be evaluated with a listing decision. So in a nutshell, basically this motion seems to be pretty strong case against this petition to delist. Now it goes, you know, for a federal judge to see what happens next. So that's sort of putting on hold our work to look into this. Yes.
Remind me which judge the Land Commission's lawsuit was filed.
It was filed in the western section of the federal court. You know, it convenes out of San Antonio, but there's an Austin division. I'm not sure. I don't remember the name of the judge.
Not sure exactly.
Yeah, it's the Western Texas division of.
And is this the kind of a thing where the two sides present their written briefs and then the judge decides, or is there a hearing? Do you know?
It's based on administrative records.
It's okay.
And so the paper.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
It's in the file.
So the motion is out there. It's available to review. It seems pretty, really solid to me.
Great.
So that's it. So that sort of put on hold our need to go into really looking further into the science behind this claim that there is inadequate review of the science. We'll see what happens from the judge's ruling. But I think that's about it. Questions?
That's good work.
Well, good. Thank you.
Thanks, Corey.
Welcome.
Number 9 is review of the updated draft guidelines for the BCCP Scientific Advisory Committee.
Yes. So in your packets, you have the updated draft guidelines, the current guidelines, and the bylaws for your reference. I worked with the SAC to create this draft of the updated guidelines. They were distributed and discussed at our last SAC meeting, and members had the chance to comment and provide feedback during the meeting and then for a couple weeks after the meeting through email. The guideline changes are similar to the CAC guideline updates approved by the coordinating committee at the last meeting, which show the reduction in the amount of regular meetings. And one of the changes requested by the SAC was to better define the composition of the SAC members' areas of expertise. They felt it was important that the committee consensus appointments strive to obtain a membership composition that includes two karst experts, one in karst biology and one in karst geology, one expert in ornithology with experience specific to the golden cheek warbler and the black-capped vireo, one expert in botany, vegetation communities, and plant ecology, and then the remainder of the three members who provide a balance between those disciplines, as well as conservation, ecology, management, and restoration. Although they also wanted to add a social science as a discipline that may be important when considering additional areas of expertise. Everybody in the SAC has provided input and is agreeable with the new guidelines, so we are asking the coordinating committee to approve these new guidelines today.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That passes unanimously. Number 10 is to receive the BCP partner reports.
Okay.
So I'm Nico Howard, Program Manager for the City of Austin Balcones Canyonland Preserve. And do you want to go first?
We can.
Okay.
All right. I'm Linda Locke. I'm Natural Resources Field Supervisor for Travis County. And our packet, or our update is in your packet, but so we'll just cover a few items. The one that I would like to talk to you about today is that we have documented a new invasive species on the preserve for the first time, which is the tawny crazy ant. So this South American ant was first found in Texas in 2002 and in Travis County in 2011. So we've reported in the past that we have found them in two of the caves that are listed on our permit that are owned by private entities. But we have not previously documented them on the preserve itself. So now we've found them on our Collins tract, which is located near the Anderson Mill Road FM 2769 intersection. And this tract is part of our large Jollyville unit, so we expect that they'll continue to expand onto the preserve. We're not sure exactly what the impacts will be, but we know that they tend to disrupt other invertebrate populations, and they get in buildings and they damage electrical units and things like that. So we're going to be closely monitoring the population and trying to determine what the impacts are, especially to the species on our permit.
What do you do about eradicating them? How do you get rid of them?
It's going to be challenging because chemical controls usually aren't very effective for these ants. They don't readily go to baits like other ants, and they aren't very territorial, and they have multi-queen colonies, so they can rebound very quickly. There's some research now going on biological control, particularly like disease pathogens, so that may have some promise. But it's all still kind of in the works as to how we're going to handle that.
I'd like to add to that our staff at city and county and have been working with a UT researcher, and we with a grant from Craig's group, Section 6 research grant, for several years now to figuring out how to address this. And they are working actively right now on a final report, or at least a final report for that stage of their research. And they've indicated that there is a promising approach to working with it, so we have reason for optimism. At least I do. I'm told that they have a couple ideas that might help, but we're looking forward to getting that report at the end of this year, the beginning of next year, and we'll be rolling out presentations on that from the researchers themselves. If you have, you know about this, is there anything else you would want to say about that?
Just that we're waiting on the report, and he does have some clues about some ways to treat tawny crazy ants, which otherwise are very challenging, and it's very innovative because you have to look at natural predators in Argentina and Brazil. And so we're waiting on him to come up with a report, because as a researcher, you're kind of worried about that if you tell people in advance, it gets, people steer your publishing stuff, and that does really happen all the time. So I totally respect his need to finish the report and then let us know what they found. But he apparently has some promising leads.
I just have one thing to add on the county side, and that is that we had a couple significant purchases since we were here last. We bought the 2,319-acre Wheelis tract from the LCRA so we could secure it permanently for protection in the BCP even after the permit expires. And that was really critical to us to secure that macrosite. The county had property all around the edge, and now we have the macrosite, the core area. So we're happy about that. Another piece of property we acquired is, brings us to the road at the intersection of 2222 and Highway 620 from the Blackmore family. And that's another one that we've been looking at for years and were able to acquire. We're happy about it. Johanna Arendt is going to show you a video that we've been working on, but why don't we save that for after all those staff reports and let her show that last. Would that be okay?
Yeah, sure. That'd be fine, yeah.
So.
All right. Thank you.
So some of the during the quarter, the Leslie Poole and City Council recognized Jill Harding of Bowie High School for her efforts to restore one of the caves under Bowie High School, which was an awesome effort you did over several decades and a real example for us on cave restoration, which she had done on it. And she was very honored by it. The school put her name on the bulletin board, you know, and you drive by. So it was, it made a big difference that she was finally recognized for all the work she did on that, on the cave restoration. We have some new employees at Austin Water. We have a outreach coordinator, Kate McCann, who's been working with us for a while, but she's now a permanent position as an outreach coordinator. And also we have Audrey Stewart, who is a volunteer coordinator. She's new to the BCP. And so both of them represent the bulk of our outreach, and we are looking to expand our outreach to do a lot than we have in the past as far as the BCP goes. The regarding the Golden Cheek Warbler, the intensive surveys that we do are the most precise way of measuring the territories that you can measure. So it takes a lot of effort on our part. You know, we do some banding of birds. We've banded 81 Golden Cheek Warblers this season, the last spring season. It's a very staff intensive effort to do these intensive surveys, but very necessary to get really accurate numbers to compare it. If you want to compare it to a model or anything else, you need really precise numbers on the Golden Cheek Warbler. So we had another successful year of that, and also monitoring for the black-capped vireo. And Craig mentioned about the lawsuit, so I won't get into that regarding delisting the Golden Cheek Warbler. The bracketed twist flower is one of the rare plants that we are charged with protecting as well. So we did surveys of them. We observed one area where they're known to be on private property that seems to be threatened by construction activity near Cat Mountain and along 2222. But it's on private property. It's not one of our BCP properties. As far as the cave invertebrates, you know, we continue our faunal surveys, Cape Ricketts accounts to measure the diversity of the cave, and doing some restoration on some sites. The blow-in sink tract, I mentioned we did a big restoration project, and we did a lot of revegetation on it, continued watering it this year, hoping to get some really nutritious food for the cave crickets. And so we were doing also Cape Ricketts accounts there, to hopefully boost up the cave ecosystems by revegetating the area. And we've been doing a similar project at McNeil High School. We're working with the teacher there, Tina Vick, to vegetate the areas where there's caves of endangered species, caves that aren't a BCP permit cave, but they're still endangered species cave. And we hope to have a success going there as well. We're participating with a study with the Austin Health Department and Texas State and Baylor University to study soft body ticks in caves. And there have been cases where citizens have gotten a relapsing fever from caves on Barton Creek. And so we're very happy to have them working with us to evaluate particularly caves, but sometimes it's just in open areas where you can get soft body ticks, relapsing fever. The doctors have a hard time recognizing it, and there's a general not a lot of education about it. Those of us that are cavers, you know, probably have had it once or twice. I've had it twice, and we know about it, but most of the public doesn't. So it's a hard for them to recognize, and for us to protect the citizens, we need to know where is it. You know, particularly if it's an education cave, we need to know is it there. Also, we're trying to hopefully experiment with restoration efforts that could eradicate the soft body ticks from, for example, caves where they're in now, and that's a future hope.
So, you know, habitat restoration continuing on the Vireo site, and I mentioned about the blow and sink site. So that's the, I'm going to stop there on the report, and you've got the some more details there in the report for you.
Thank you.
You want to show the video?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure. Great.
So just a little intro. This is the one we told you about. It's a public act or a public outreach video, just a 101 about what the BCP is and how it was created, how you're going to get access to it. It's been a big collaboration between a lot of different people, including Dale Cornaby with the media services and Kayla in our group, and City of Austin and lots of great partners, including Adam, who's interviewed in the video. So enjoy.
Years after it was permitted by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, you see tremendous economic growth in the city of Austin and in Travis County, combined with endangered species being protected. And it's an amazing story that you can do both.
While some people saw it as a conflict, others saw it as the ability to grow your economy, but at the same time, the very reason you could do that was the environment. And people wanted to be out in that environment. They wanted clean water, hike and bike trails, beautiful green hills. So one of the reasons this ended up being a win-win is because it better, far better, melded the growing economy, the people economy, if you will, with why they wanted to be here to begin with. And that was the beauty of the place.
It's not just about the words on the page. It's about the people who every day work on it. And it's about the community that supports it. And it's about what it means to this community. Yes, it was about endangered species and preserving endangered species habitat, but it's also about preserving what makes Austin special.
Really nice.
That's good.
like to thank Dale.
Thank you,
right
Dale.
Here.
Yeah.
And Russell Hughes donated that drone photography. As did Brett and Whitney did the Black Cat vireo footage, and that's all donated. And we had the karst species photography from Jean Krejka and Robert and Linda Mitchell and Piers Hendry, and so that was all donated as well. So we had a lot of really wonderful partners on this.
That's great.
Yeah,
that's
great.
Music was written and performed by our own staff.
It's really nice. Really nice. And good guitar work. Is that up on the website?
Not yet. I wanted to show it to y'all first, get
I'd
your feedback.
I'd love to get that link.
I'll tell you what our plan is. Okay. we have been working on an update to our county website, and the plan is to have that video as part of it when we launch the update.
It is actually right now posted on YouTube, but just because that was a link that we could use to send out to the folks who donated material so we could show it to them, it hasn't been promoted or anything yet. But that is another avenue we can promote it through social media and that sort of thing. And it'll be shown on Travis County TV as well.
We'll send it to Gerald and me, and I'm sure we'll also advance it on social media. You're on social media, aren't you, Gerald?
You bet.
There was a video of you.
A pretty popular one. Maybe we get it to 10 million like that one was. That drone stuff is great, though. I mean, what you can do with drone is unbelievable. You could have never gotten that, you know, the creek, you know, and all of that without it.
Yeah, I fully agree. And there's lots of footage, actually, that we didn't use in the video. And he has volunteered to do more footage for the county, and so we're really looking forward to using more of that.
Very nice. Thanks for showing it to us.
Great job.
Fantastic.
Were there any other? Nico, did you do all the cities? Okay.
You always got that
group with you. I mean, I thought maybe they wanted to say something.
Well, we'd be glad to read it to you, but ours is all in the report.
So the next is 11, which is just the announcement that the next BCC Coordinating Committee meeting will be December the 1st, and that will be at 12, or from 10 to 12 noon, that will be at City Hall. So if there's no other business, we stand adjourned.
Sounds good to me. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Thank y'all.